Whoever wishes to come after me must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me, says the Lord. I repeat, whoever wishes to come after me must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, may the glory of God descend upon you who have gathered here in this holy place to worship him, as we renew our promises today to become his disciples. The readings we just heard today, especially the gospel, explains that the basic of our faith is in acceptance of Jesus as the Christ, the Son of the living God. The Christ who through his sufferings, death, and resurrection saved us from sin. If we are to have a share in his suffering and experience the grace of his death and resurrection, we must follow him daily, denying ourselves and taking up our cross. So what is a disciple? How is different between a disciple of someone versus a disciple of Jesus Christ? A disciple is a follower or a student who is learning from his master. A disciple who disciplines himself or herself in the teachings and practices of another. In biblical times, a disciple referred to anyone studying under and trying to emulate a valued teacher. To modern-day Christians, it means a follower of Christ who lives by following his example. And the follow-up question is, what does it take to be a disciple of Jesus? A disciple is the one who has been baptized and is willing to take upon him or her the name of Savior and follow him. In other words, a disciple strives to become as he is being by keeping his commandments in morality, much the same as a learner seeks to become like his or her master. In a Christian context, we are all disciples of Christ. There can never be a true disciple without discipline. Every disciple of Christ must be ready to follow in the discipline of their master. They need faith and discipline to be true disciple of Christ. Faith, because we need to believe in the one we follow. We need to recognize who he is, as Peter did, and is disciplined because we have to follow the rules, deny, take up, and follow. Nowadays, people follow many things: Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, sport models, actors, singers, and so on. Many virtue of having many followers on the social media, while they have on one to follow. People follow many celebrities and fans online, but hardly follow Christ and His ways. They give thumbs up and likes to those who follow on social media, but do not like anything about the gospel. People spend many hours watching those they follow on social media, but get bored reading the Bible, or listening to the homilies, or teaching of the church. In reality, many people do not follow Christ because he speaks of the denial of oneself as the first disciple of his followers. Self-denial is an act of letting go of the self, as with self-sacrificing abstinence, the willingness to forego personal pleasures or undergo personal trials in the pursuit of increased good of others. In the first reading of today, from the third suffering servant, the Song of Isaiah, the aspect of Christ's own life and mission are foreshadowed. Christ's life is one of radical obedience and conformity to God's will. How could Christ have done this if he didn't deny his royalty and kingly pledge to die as a servant? This is exactly what he calls us to do. But this is very hard for us because we are naturally selfish, and it is grace that makes the difference in our lives. St. James, with our harshing words in the second reading, highlights the aspect of self-denial in respect to our faith in Christ. James explains how our faith in Jesus, the Messiah, should help us to alleviate the sufferings of others by our works of mercy, both corporal and spiritual. Hence, faith without good works is dead, and without self-denial, good work is impossible. This Sunday, we are invited to look at our lives and to compare our lives with the life of Jesus. Are we ready to suffer and die for our faith? Can we follow Jesus? Can we accept his church with all of its defects and its sins and sinful people? It is much easier to believe in Jesus than to believe in his church. But if we don't believe in the church, we no longer believe in the incarnation and thus no longer really believe in Jesus as Lord, as God, and man, as our Savior. Let us pray today for the graces we need to live a life of Christ's discipleship, and willing to pay the personal price, remaining faithful to the gospel of love and truth, confident that nothing we do will be in vain. Amen.
I wish it was different, but sadly it is not. I wish it was different for me personally, for us as a parish, for us as a nation, for us as a universal church, but sadly it is not. I wish it was different, but I keep forgetting. I keep being distracted. I keep being more concerned about the third note on the musical scale. Do, re, mi, mi, mi. Selfishness, self-centeredness, and self-concern all too often defines human history and human reality. The history of the Old Testament and the chosen people is a history of forgetting. Forgetting God's covenant, forgetting God's laws, forgetting God's guidance, forgetting God's never-ending patience, forgetting that God draws them back to himself over and over again. Oh, they remember for a while and repent, and then they forget over and over again. Now, I know we are all concerned about many things. We have families, jobs, first weeks of school, doctor's appointments, sicknesses, COVID restrictions and COVID mandates, and so many societal challenges that all scream for our attention. Plus, we have all sorts of plans. Plans for this and plans for that. Plans of what we're going to do, what we want to do, what we'd like to do. I wish it was different. But all too often we keep forgetting about the plan, God's plan, God's eternal plan. And as a result, we get into all sorts of problems. I wish it was different, but it is not. As usual, I had more to do than I had time to do this week. I had deadlines and decisions, marriage prep and funeral prep, our stewardship retreat yesterday and stewardship plans for the future. There were concerns of parishioners around mandates and vaccines. I had a couple of dinner plans, as well as preparation plans for a few days of retreat at the beginning of this week. Oh, and I also had a plan to prepare this homily and have enough time to do so, but oh well. I wish it was different, but in the midst of my plans, I forgot again. I forgot something very important. It wasn't until I read a short reflection in preparation for yesterday's morning mass that I remembered that it was 9/11. And my heart sank. How could I forget? In an instant, my prayer shifted. I found myself crying out for deliverance, healing, for comfort and consolation for so many families who 20 years later are still grieving, still remembering, still hurting. The more I prayed, the more I remembered. And the more I remembered, the more I needed to pray. It was 5:30 a.m., so I turned on the television to watch the simple ceremony at the 9/11 memorial in New York. I remembered exactly when I heard the news. If you are old enough to remember, I suspect you do as well. Like me, most of you likely remember where you were and what you were doing. You remember the feelings that swept over you, that punched you in the gut, knocked you off your feet, leaving you gasping for air and understanding. What is happening? I was in Rome on sabbatical. One of the other priests with me caught me in the hall and told me to come down to watch the news on the television. I gasped in horror. We 20 priests stood there watching a very fuzzy picture, seeing images thousands of miles away, and feeling so disconnected from our parishes, from our parishioners. And then the second plane hit the other tower. I wish it was different, but it is not. I keep forgetting. We keep forgetting. As a people and a nation, we keep forgetting and hence keep making the same mistakes. Sin wins over and over again. Satan, the father of lies, the great deceiver of souls, the great divider, keeps winning these daily battles and skirmishes, and we keep surrendering more and more territory of our souls. Then Peter took Jesus aside and began to rebuke him. Peter, who had just professed Jesus as the Christ, the anointed one, the Messiah, who, like King David, would unite the tribes of Israel with military and political might, rebukes Jesus, the teacher. Peter saw Jesus teaching that the Son of Man must suffer greatly and be rejected and killed as crazy talk, not who the Messiah was supposed to be. Unwittingly, Peter became the voice of Satan, tempting the Lord to reject suffering as a result of faithful witness to the Father's eternal plan. Rejection, suffering, and death were not in Peter's plan for Jesus, or for himself for that matter. At this, Jesus turned around and, looking at his disciples, rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan. You are thinking not as God does, but as human beings do." This command of Jesus is not a banishment, but rather an instruction, a teaching in discipleship. Peter, and hence all of us, can only be a disciple when we follow Jesus and not try to lead Jesus where we want him to go. Before anyone can be an apostle, that is, one who is sent, who leads others, that person must first be a disciple who is constantly following Jesus. When we try to become a leader of others without following the Lord, we risk seeking our own will rather than the will of God. Our erroneous pursuit of self-will means that we can end up on the wrong side of the struggle between the kingdom of God and evil. I wish it was different, but it is not. I keep forgetting and need to be reminded over and over. I keep forgetting that to follow Christ means this: whoever wishes to come after me must deny oneself, take up their cross, and follow me. For whoever wishes to save one's life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for my sake and that of the gospel will save it. I wish it was different, but it is not. I keep forgetting that to truly live, I must die. To truly live, I must sacrifice. To truly live, I must lay down my life, my selfishness, my self-centeredness over and over and over again. as mundane and minuscule as it might be in my daily life. What I don't wish was different is that when I do remember, when I follow Jesus and give myself to others, then I realize in the depth of my soul a joy, a peace, and a hope that surpasses the stinginess of my self-centeredness. Men, fathers, be a disciple of Jesus Christ and lay down your life for your spouse, your children, your siblings and your family, and for the Catholic Church. Sacrifice, men. Don't put yourself first. Put Jesus first, then others, and then yourself. Ladies, moms, do the same. Children, no matter what your age, be a disciple of Jesus Christ and lay down your life for your family, for your mom and dad, your siblings, your grandparents, your aunts and uncles, your friends, and others who need you. I wish it was different, but it is not. What can make everything different? Following Jesus and being his disciple. Receiving Jesus in holy community, holding divinity in your hand. What can be more important than the Eucharist? Yet Satan keeps battling, keeps winning, because we keep forgetting. Maybe not so much you and I personally, because we are here. We are trying to do this in remembrance of him. Yet so many have an amnesia. Our nation keeps forgetting. Our public schools push God out of the classrooms. Our politics punish. Our self-centered individualism is alienating us from one another. We can't talk to each other. We slam each other on social media. The common good is usurped by what is good for me, what I define me to be. This is a cosmic dead end. My sisters and brothers, let us seek to hear with new ears these words that we pray at the end of the consecration prayer at Mass. Do this in remembrance of me. Let us never forget.